Welcome to this Good Friday service at First Presbyterian Church in Mount Airy. This is a service of storytelling and song and prayer. We will walk through the scriptures that tell us of the passion of the Lord Jesus. As we do that, we will hear songs that connect our hearts with the story. And then we will lift up all our hearts to God, praying for the world that He creates, redeemed, and sustains. Thank you for joining us with us. And would you pray with me? Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, who for our redemption gave your only Son to death on the cross, and by his glorious resurrection delivered us from the power of our enemy, grant us so to die daily to sin, that we may evermore live with him in the joy of his resurrection, now and forever. Amen. Now join me in singing, O Sacred Head Now Wounded. Shall prosper. He shall be exalted and lifted up and shall be very high. Just as there were many who were astounded at him, so marred was his appearance beyond human semblance and his form beyond that of mortals. So shall he startle many nations. Kings shall shut their mouths because of him, for that which they have not told them they shall see, and that which they have not heard they shall contemplate. Who has believed what we have heard? And to whom has the arm of the Lord been revealed? He grew up before him like a young plant, like a root out of dry ground. He had no form or majesty that we should look at him, nothing in his appearance that we should desire him. He was despised and rejected by others, a man of suffering and acquainted with infirmity. And as one from whom others hide their face, he was despised, and we held him of no account. Surely he has borne our infirmities and carried our diseases, yet we acknowledged him stricken, struck down by God and afflicted. But he was wounded for our transgressions, crushed for our iniquities. Upon him was the punishment that made us whole, and by his bruises we are healed. All we like sheep have gone astray, each one to their own way, and the Lord has laid on him the iniquities of us all. He was oppressed and he was afflicted, yet he did not open his mouth. Like a lamb that is led to the slaughter, and like a sheep that before its shears is silent, so he did not open his mouth. By a perversion of justice he was taken away. Who could have imagined his future? For he was cut off from the land of the living, stricken for the transgression of my people. They made his grave with the wicked and his tomb with the rich, although he had done no violence and there was no deceit in his mouth. Yet it was the will of the Lord to crush him with pain. When you make his life an offering for sin, he shall see his offsprings and shall prolong his days. Through him the will of the Lord shall prosper. Out of his anguish he shall see light. He shall find satisfaction through his knowledge. The righteous one, my servant, shall make many righteous, and he shall bear their iniquities. Therefore I will allot him a portion with the great, and he shall divide the spoil with the strong, because he poured out himself to death and was numbered with the transgressors. Yet he bore the sin of many and made intercession for the transgressors. This too is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Our second reading comes from Psalm 69, verses 1 through 23, and is responsive. Save me, O God, for the waters have come up to my neck.
I sink in deep mire, where there is no foothold.
I have come into deep waters, and the flood sweeps over me.
I'm weary with my crying, my throat is parched.
My eyes grow dim with waiting for my God.
More in number than the hairs of my head are those who hate me without cause. Many are those who would destroy me, my enemies who accuse me falsely.
What I did not steal, must I now restore?
O God, you know my folly. The wrongs I have done are not hidden from you.
Do not let those who hope in you be put to shame because of me, O Lord God of hosts.
Do not let those who seek you be dishonored because of me, O God of Israel.
It is for your sake that I have borne reproach, that shame has covered my face.
I have become a stranger to my kindred, an alien to my mother's children.
It is zeal for your house that has consumed me. The insults of those who insult you and have fallen on me.
When I humbled my soul with fasting, they insulted me for doing so.
When I made sackcloth my clothing, I became a byword to them.
I am the subject of gossip for those who sit in the gate, and the drunkards make songs about me.
But as for me, my prayer is to you, O Lord.
and an acceptable time, O God, in the abundance of your steadfast love, answer me.
With your faithful help, rescue me from sinking in the mire.
Let me be delivered from my enemies and from the deep waters.
Do not let the flood sweep over me, or the deep swallow me up, or the pit close its mouth over me.
Answer me, O Lord, for your steadfast love is good. According to your abundant mercy, turn to me.
Do not hide your face from your servant, for I am in distress. Make haste to answer me.
Draw near to me, redeem me, set me free because of my enemies.
You know the insults I receive and my shame and dishonor. My foes are all known to you.
Insults have broken my heart, so that I am in despair.
I looked for pity, but there was none, and for comforters I found none.
They gave me poison for food, and for my thirst they gave me vinegar to drink.
Let their table be a trap for them, a snare for their allies.
Let their eyes be darkened so that they cannot see, and make their loins tremble continually.
This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The Passion of our Lord Jesus Christ, according to John. After Jesus had spoken these words, he went out with his disciples across the Kidron Valley to a place where there was a garden, which he and his disciples entered. Now Judas, who betrayed him, also knew the place, because Jesus often met there with his disciples. So Judas brought a detachment of soldiers together with police from the chief priests and the Pharisees, and they came there with lanterns and torches and weapons. Then Jesus, knowing all that was to happen to him, came forward and asked them, "Who are you looking for?" They answered, "Jesus of Nazareth." Jesus replied, "I am he." Judas, who betrayed him, was standing with them. When Jesus said to them, "I am he," they stepped back and fell to the ground. Again he asked them, "Whom are you looking for?" And they said, "Jesus of Nazareth." Jesus answered, "I told you that I am he. So if you are looking for me, let these men go." This was to fulfill the word that he had spoken, "And did not lose a single one of those whom you gave me." Then Simon Peter, who had a sword, drew it, struck the high priest's slave, and cut off his right ear. The slave's name was Malchus. Jesus said to Peter, "Put your sword back into its sheath. Am I not to drink the cup of the Father has given me?" So the soldiers, their officer, and the Jewish police arrested Jesus and bound him. First they took him to Annas, who was the father-in-law of Caiaphas, the high priest that year. Caiaphas was the one who had advised the Jews that it was better to have one person die for the people. Simon Peter and another disciple followed Jesus. Since that disciple was known to the high priest, he went with Jesus into the courtyard of the high priest. But Peter was standing outside at the gate. So the other disciple, who was known to the high priest, went out, spoke to the woman who guarded the gate, and brought Peter in. The woman said to Peter, "You are not also one of the man's disciples, are you?" He said, "I am not." Now the slaves and the police had made a charcoal fire because it was cold, and they were standing around it and warming themselves. Peter also was standing with them and warming himself. Then the high priest questioned Jesus about his disciples and about his teaching. Jesus answered, "I have spoken openly to the world. I have always taught in synagogues and in the temple, where all the Jews come together. I have said nothing in secret. Why do you ask me? Ask those who heard what I said to them. They know what I said." When he had said this, one of the police standing nearby struck Jesus in the face, saying, "Is that how you answer the high priest?" Jesus answered, "If I have spoken wrongly, testify to the wrong. But if I have spoken rightly, why do you strike me?" Then Annas sent him bound to Caiaphas, the high priest. Now Simon Peter was standing and warming himself. They asked him, "Are you not also one of the disciples, are you?" He denied it and said, "I am not." One of the slaves of the high priest, a relative of the man whose ear Peter had cut off, asked, "Did I not see you in the garden with him?" Again, Peter denied it, and at that moment, the cock crowed.
Defilement and to be able to eat the Passover. So Pilate went out to them and said, What accusation do you bring against this man?" They answered, "If this man were not a criminal, we would not have handed him over to you." Pilate said to them, "Take him yourselves and judge him according to your law." The Jews replied, "We are not permitted to put anyone to death." This was to fulfill what Jesus had said when he indicated the kind of death he was to die. Then Pilate entered the headquarters again, summoned Jesus, and asked him, "Are you the king of the Jews?" Jesus answered, "Do you ask this on your own, or did others tell you about me?" Pilate replied, "I am not a Jew, am I? Your own nation and the chief priests have handed you over to me. What have you done?" Jesus answered, "My kingdom is not from this world. If my kingdom were from this world, my followers would be fighting to keep me from being handed over to the Jews. But as it is, my kingdom is not from here." Pilate asked him, "So you are a king?" Jesus answered, "You say that I am a king. For this I was born, and for this I came into the world, to testify to the truth. Everyone who belongs to the truth listens to my voice." Pilate asked him, "What is truth?" After he had said this, he went out to the Jews again and told them, "I find no case against him, but you have a custom that I release someone for you at the Passover. Do you want me to release for you the king of the Jews?" They shouted in reply, "Not this man, but Barabbas." Now Barabbas was a bandit. When Pilate took Jesus and had him flogged, and the soldiers wove a crown of thorns and put it on his head, and they dressed him in a purple robe, they kept coming up to him saying, "Hail, King of the Jews," and striking him on the face. Pilate went out again and said to them, "Look, I'm bringing him out to you to let you know that I find no case against him." So Jesus came out wearing the crown of thorns and the purple robe. Pilate said to them, "Here is the man." When the chief priests and the police saw him, they shouted, "Crucify him! Crucify him!" Pilate said to them, "Take him yourselves and crucify him. I find no case against him." The Jews answered him, "We have a law, and according to that law, he ought to die because he has claimed to be the Son of Man." Now when Pilate heard this, he was more afraid than ever. He entered his headquarters again and asked Jesus, "Where are you from?" But Jesus gave him no answer. Pilate therefore said to him, "Do you refuse to speak to me? Do you not know that I have power to release you and power to crucify you?" Jesus answered him, "You would have no power over me unless it had been given to you from above. Therefore, the one who handed me over to you is guilty of a greater sin." From then on, Pilate tried to release him, but the Jews cried out, "If you release this man, you are no friend of the emperor. Everyone who claims to be a king sets himself against the emperor." When Pilate heard these words, he brought Jesus outside and sat on the judge's bench at a place called the Stone Pavement, or in Hebrew, Gabbatha. Now it was the day of preparation for the Passover, and it was about noon. He said to the Jews, "Here is your king." They cried out, "Away with him! Away with him! Crucify him!" Pilate asked them, "Shall I crucify your king?" The chief priests answered, "We have no king but the emperor." Then he handed him over to them to be crucified.
Written and put on the cross. It read, "Jesus of Nazareth, the King of the Jews." Many of the Jews read this inscription because the place where Jesus was crucified was near the city, and it was written in Hebrew, in Latin, and in Greek. Then the chief priests of the Jews said to Pilate, "Do not write, 'The King of the Jews,' but 'This man said, I am King of the Jews.'" Pilate answered, "What I have written, I have written." When the soldiers had crucified Jesus, they took his clothes and divided them into four parts, one for each soldier. They also took his tunic. Now the tunic was seamless, woven in one piece from the top. So they said to one another, "Let us not tear it, but cast lots for it, to see who will get it." This was to fulfill what the scripture says. They divided my clothes among themselves, and for my clothing they cast lots. And that is what the soldiers did. Meanwhile, standing near the cross of Jesus were his mother and his mother's sister, Mary, the wife of Clopas, and Mary Magdalene. When Jesus saw his mother and the disciple whom he loved standing beside her, he said to his mother, "Woman, here is your son." Then he said to the disciple, "Here is your mother." And from that hour, the disciple took her into his own home. After this, when Jesus knew that all was now finished, he said, in order to fulfill the scripture, "I am thirsty." A jar full of sour wine was standing there, so they put a sponge full of the wine on a branch of hyssop and held it to his mouth. When Jesus had received the wine, he said, "It is finished." Then he bowed his head and gave up his spirit.
Soldiers pierced his side with a spear, and at once blood and water came out. He who saw this has testified so that you also may believe. His testimony is true, and he knows that he tells the truth. These things occurred so that the scripture might be fulfilled. None of his bones shall be broken. And again, another passage of scripture says, they will look on the one whom they have pierced. After these things, Joseph of Arimathea, who was a disciple of Jesus, though a secret one because of his fear of the Jews, asked Pilate to let him take away the body of Jesus. Pilate gave him permission, so he came and removed his body. Nicodemus, who had at first come to Jesus by night, also came, bringing a mixture of myrrh and aloes, weighing about 100 pounds. They took the body of Jesus and wrapped it with the spices and linen cloths, according to the burial custom of the Jews. Now there was a garden in the place where he was crucified, and in the garden there was a new tomb in which no one had ever been laid. And so, because it was the Jewish day of preparation, and the tomb was nearby, they laid Jesus there.
Particular places, the high priest court, the stone pavement, particular phrases, blood and water, I am thirsty, particular times, about noon, that hour, late that night. That's what I notice being there, but I also notice what is not there. There are not a lot of details of the torture. The agony that Jesus experiences is not the focus. Those are not the details that we are given. I assume that the gospel writers know that life teaches us about those details on our own, on its own. We don't need the scriptures to paint us a picture of torture and injustice. We need the scriptures to paint us a picture of redemption. And that's what this story is about. God entering into the pain and bringing something new, of saying no to death and yes to life. And the invitation of this Good Friday and of every day is for us to see this redemptive work being fleshed out in the details of our life. This kitchen sink, this recliner, this address, these people, this pandemic, this depression, this joy, this spring day in all its beauty, this spring day in all its cloudiness. These are the particular places where this passion of Jesus gets worked out in us. So, in this service on this Good Friday, we now pray. We now bring before God all the places in the world that need His care and His concern. This is a prayer that has been prayed for centuries throughout the world, modified for today. But join me in praying these solemn collects. Dear people of God, God sent Jesus into the world not to condemn the world, but that through the world, but that the world might, through Him, might be saved. That all who believe in Him might be delivered from the power of sin and death, and become heirs with Him of eternal life. Let us pray for the one holy Catholic and apostolic Church of Christ throughout the world, for its unity in witness and service, for all church leaders and ministers and the people whom they serve, for all the people of this presbytery, for all Christians in this community, for those who are about to be baptized, that God will confirm the church in faith, increase it in love, and preserve it in peace. Eternal God, by your Spirit, the whole body of your faithful people is governed and sanctified. Receive our prayers, which we offer before you for all members of your holy church, that in our vocation and ministry we may truly and devoutly serve you through our Lord Jesus Christ. Let us pray for all nations and peoples of the earth, and for those in authority among them, for the President, for the Congress, for the Supreme Court, for the members and representatives of the United Nations, for all who serve the common good, that by God's help they may seek justice and truth and live in peace and concord. Almighty God, kindle, we pray, in every heart the true love of peace, and guide with your wisdom those who take counsel for the nations of the earth. Justice and peace may increase until the earth is filled with the knowledge of your love through Jesus Christ our Lord. Let us pray for all who suffer and are afflicted in body or in mind, for the hungry and homeless, the destitute and oppressed, for all who suffer persecution, doubt, and despair, for the sorrowful and bereaved, for prisoners and captives, for those in mortal danger, that God will comfort and relieve them and grant them the knowledge of God's love and stir up in us the will and patience to minister to their needs. Gracious God, the comfort of all who sorrow, the strength of all who suffer, hear the cry of those in misery and need. In their afflictions, show them your mercy, and give us, we pray, the strength to serve them for the sake of him who suffered for us, your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Let us pray for all who fight COVID-19 and the coronavirus, the ill who are unaware, the ill who suffer at home or in a hospital ICU, the healthcare providers, the public health officials, first responders, pharmacologists and scientists, janitors and orderlies, the refugee, the widow, the orphan, the prisoner, the isolated and alone. Jesus, healer, Hosanna, Jesus, save them, strengthen them, and comfort them in your name. Let us pray for all who have not received the gospel of Christ, for all who have not heard the words of salvation, for all who have lost their faith, for all whose sin has made them indifferent to Christ, for all who actively oppose Christ in word or deed, for all who are enemies of the cross of Christ and persecutors of his disciples, for all who in the name of Christ have persecuted others, that God will open their hearts to the truth and lead them to faith and obedience. Merciful God, creator of the peoples of the earth and lovers and lover of souls, have compassion on all who do not know you, as you are revealed in your Son, Jesus Christ. Let your gospel be preached with grace and power to those who have not heard it. Turn the hearts of those who resist it and bring home to your flock those who have gone astray, that there may be one fold under one shepherd, Jesus Christ our Lord. Let us commit ourselves to God and pray for the grace of a holy life, that with all who are departed this life and have died in the peace of Christ, and those whose faith is known to God alone, we may be accounted worthy to enter into the fullness of the joy of our Lord and receive the crown of life in the day of resurrection. Eternal God of unchanging power and light, look with mercy on your whole church. Bring to completion your saving work so that the whole world may see the fallen lifted up, the old made new, and all things brought to perfection by him through whom all things were made, our Lord Jesus Christ, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, and now and forever. Finally, let us pray for all those things for which our Lord would have us ask, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever. Amen. Behold the cross on which was hung the salvation of the whole world.
Come, let us worship.
Behold the cross on which was hung the salvation of the whole world.
Come, let us worship.
Behold the cross on which was hung the salvation of the whole world.
Come, let us worship.
We glory in your cross, O Lord, and praise and glorify your holy resurrection,
for by virtue of the cross, joy has come to the whole world. May God be merciful to us and bless us, and show us the light of his countenance and come to us.
Let your ways be known upon earth, your saving health among all nations.
Let the peoples praise you, O God. Let all the peoples praise you.
We glory in your cross, O Lord, and praise and glorify your holy resurrection. For by virtue of your cross, joy has come to the whole world.
O my people, O my church, what have I done to you? Or in what have I offended you? Answer me. I led you forth from the land of Egypt and delivered you by the waters of baptism, but you have prepared a cross for your Savior.
Lord, have mercy.
I led you through the desert 40 years and fed you with manna. I brought you through tribulation and penitence and gave you my body, the bread of heaven, but you have prepared a cross for your Savior.
Lord, have mercy.
What more could I have done for you that I have not done? I planted you my chosen and fairest vineyard. I made you the branches of my vine. But when I was thirsty, you gave me vinegar to drink and pierced with a spear the side of your Savior. And you have prepared a cross for your Savior.
Lord, have mercy.
I went before you in a pillar of cloud, and you have led me to the judgment hall of Pilate. I scourged your enemy and brought you to a land of freedom, but you have scourged, mocked, and beaten me. I gave you water of salvation from the rock, but you have given me gall and left me to thirst, and you have prepared a cross for your Savior.
Lord, have mercy.
I gave you a royal scepter and bestowed the keys to the kingdom, but you have given me a crown of thorns. I raised you on high with great power, but you have prepared a cross for your Savior.
Lord, have mercy.
My peace I give, which the world cannot give, and washed your feet as a sign of my love. But you draw the sword to strike in my name and seek high places in my kingdom. I offered you my body and blood, but you scatter and deny and abandon me, and you have prepared a cross for your Savior.
Lord, have mercy.
I sent the Spirit of truth to guide you, and you close your hearts to the Counselor. I pray that all may be one in the Father and me, but you continue to quarrel and divide. I call you to go and bring forth fruit, but you cast lots for my clothing, and you have prepared a cross for your Savior.
Lord, have mercy.
I grafted you into the tree of my chosen Israel, and you turned on them with persecution and mass murder. I made you joint heirs with them of my covenants, but you have made them scapegoats for your own guilt, and you have prepared a cross for your Savior.
Lord, have mercy.
I came to you as the least of your brothers and sisters. I was hungry, and you gave me no food. I was thirsty, and you gave me no drink. I was a stranger, and you did not welcome me, naked, and you did not clothe me, sick and in prison, and you did not visit me, and you have prepared a cross for your Savior.
Lord, have mercy.